Hi viewers, welcome to our electrical engineering lecture channel for most interactive sessions of different subjects of electronic and electrical engineering. For the latest updates and videos, don't forget to subscribe and click the like button.
Welcome to another video. In the previous videos, we have already discussed two very basic properties of LTI systems, which are linearity and time invariance. In this video, we will be discussing two another very important properties related with LTI systems, which are causality and stability. Both these properties are very important because both these properties are directly related with the practical realizations of the LTI systems. Because causality means that if the output of any LTI system depends on only the present and or past values of the input and not on the future, if this condition holds, then we will say that the system is causal. Or the same condition can also be checked in a different way, as if the impulse response h of t of any LTI system, if that impulse response is non-zero only for t greater than or equal to zero, that is, h of t is non-zero only for the non-negative values of time, then in this case the system will be called causal. So these are the two methods to check the causality of the LTI system. And an important point is that if any LTI system is not causal or non-causal, then that system cannot be realizable. So that system will not be physically realizable. It cannot be implemented practically. And the second property is stability. It is also very important because if the system is unstable, it becomes very difficult to implement such systems by using some finite memories. And there are different definitions of stability, but in this video we will be discussing the most famous definition of stability, which is most widely used in the benchmarking of the systems, and that is BIBO stability. BIBO stands for bounded input, bounded output. So the definition of BIBO stability is that if the output of the system is always bounded for all the bounded inputs, which means that if y of t, the output of the system, is a finite number, means it is bounded for all values of the, for all the possible bounded inputs, then we will say that the system is BIBO stable. But this type of condition is usually very difficult to check for some specific systems. So instead of checking this condition, we usually go for the second condition, which says that the system will be BIBO stable if the impulse response h of t is absolutely summable. That is, if you add up the values of impulse response starting from minus infinity to infinity, and if that sum, the absolute sum, if that sum becomes a finite number, it means h of t will be absolutely summable. And if this condition holds, in that case, we will say that the system is absolutely summable. So these were only the definitions of causality and stability. Now we will discuss some examples to elaborate the concept of checking the causality and stability. So the first example is an LTI system given by y of t is equal to x of t minus 1. Now, first of all, we will check this causality. To check the causality, we have to see that whether the output of the system y of t is depending on only the present or past values or on the future values also. So to check this, let us put some value of t. Let's say t is equal to 2. So it becomes y of 2 is equal to x of 1. It means the output at t is equal to 2 is depending on the input at t is equal to 1, which means that the output is only depending on the past value of the input. Due to this reason, we will say that the system is causal. Similarly, let's take another example, which is y of t is equal to x of t plus 1. So what about this system? If you again put t is equal to 2 over here, you will see that y of 2 is equal to x of 3, which means what? This means that the output at t is equal to 2 is depending on the input at t is equal to 3, which has never occurred. So it means this is future. So the current input means at t is equal to 2 is depending on the future value of the input. Due to this reason, this system will be anti-causal. Similarly, example number 3, let's say y of t is equal to x of minus t. So the output is simply the reversed version of the input. Now if we put t is equal to 2 over here, we see that y of 2 is equal to x of minus 2, which means again that the output at t is equal to 2 is depending on the past value of the input. So by checking this, it comes to mind that this system must be causal. But remember one very, very important point, that this particular condition of causality must hold for all values of time. Now you see, if I change the value of time, let's say I put t is equal to minus 2, then it becomes y of minus 2 is equal to x of 2. Now what about this result? This is very interesting. Now the output at t is equal to minus 2 is depending on the future value of the input. So for some values of t, the condition of causality holds, but some other values of time, this condition doesn't hold. It means overall the system will be anti-causal. So we will say that the system is anti-causal, right? So now let us see the same examples and discuss their stability. So what about stability now? So the first example, which was y of t is equal to x of t minus 1. You can simply find out the impulse response of the system to check whether it is absolutely summable or not. You just simply replace x of t in place of delta of t. Delta of t in place of x of t. So in that case, the output will be equal to the impulse response. H of t is equal to delta of t minus 1. And delta of t minus 1 is simply an impulse function. So definitely, its sum is less than infinity. So due to this reason, this system will be stable. And the second way to check the same condition is you apply any bounded input. So if I apply any bounded input in place of x, it is very much clear that it is not possible that the output becomes unbounded. So due to this reason also, the system is stable. The same comment goes for y of t is equal to x of t plus 1. X of t plus 1. Here, again, if you replace delta of t in place of x of t, so impulse response becomes delta of t plus 1. So here again, if we apply any bounded input in place of x, it is very much sure that the output will always be bounded. Due to this reason, and also due to this reason that the impulse response is again absolutely summable, the system will be stable. And for the third example, again, y of t is equal to x of minus t. So it is again very much clear that if we apply any bounded input, the output will remain bounded. So again, this system will be stable. So these were the three examples in which the system is stable. Now we consider another example and see what happens if the impulse response is not absolutely summable. So in that case, y of t, let's say it is equal to 0 to infinity x of t dt. Now for this particular case, if you see now that if I apply any bounded input over here in place of x of t, let's say if I put x of t is equal to 1. Now x of t is equal to 1 is clearly a bounded input, but if I apply x of t is equal to 1 in this condition, then 0 to infinity 1 and dt, what the answer comes out to be? The answer approaches to infinity. It is not less than infinity. So the output is no more bounded. Similarly, if you put any finite number over here, in that particular case, the output will no more be bounded. So due to this reason, the system will be unstable. And also, if you find out the impulse response of the system, its impulse response h of t is simply equal to a unit step function u of t. And as per the geometry of the unit step function, it is very much clear that if you find the integral from 0 to infinity u of t magnitude, if you add up all the samples of the unit step function, the answer approaches to infinity. So due to this reason, we will say that the system is unstable. And what about the causality of the system? Let's also consider this one. Y of t is equal to 0 to infinity x of t dt. Just we have seen that its corresponding impulse response comes out to be h of t is equal to u of t. And if you plot this impulse response over time, h of t, for this example number 4, so we have to just plot the unit step, and unit step is look like this. So this is a unit step function where this is equal to 1 and this is equal to 0. So now it is very much clear again from this particular graph that this h of t is not equal to 0 for t greater than or equal to 0. So this condition tells us that the system must be causal. Similarly, if you go back to the above three examples and check the causality condition by using the impulse response, so you will be able to see that for the first example, h of t was equal to delta of t minus 1. So if I plot this h of t, so how it comes out to be? There is an impulse over here. And definitely, the condition for causality is satisfied because it is non-zero for t greater than or equal to 0. Similarly, for the second example, here, for example number 2, the impulse is located at minus 1. So here, since impulse response is non-zero for negative values of time, and when this condition holds true, the system becomes anti-causal. So with the help of these four examples, you can see that you can always check the causality and stability by using their own two conditions. For causality, you can check it by either looking at the impulse response, and the second option is you will see that whether the output is depending on the present or past values or also the future values. And similarly, for stability, you have two options. Either you can go for impulse response, that whether it is absolutely summable or not. If it is absolutely summable, the system will be stable, and vice versa. And the second option is you will check that whether the output of the system remains bounded for all the possible bounded inputs or not. So these were some examples and concepts of causality and stability. Thank you for listening.